Well, good morning once again, everybody. And we are in the midst of the season of Lent, the season in which the church sets 40 days aside to join Jesus in the desert. At the beginning of his ministry, Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, and then the Spirit led him out into the wilderness where he fasted for 40 days and was tempted by Satan. And so it says in the scriptures. And so we, as the church, set aside 40 days out of the year every year in order to remember that aspect of Jesus's ministry, that aspect of giving up some of the pleasures of life in order to gain focus and clarity in our own relationships with God so that we can go into the Easter season prepared to be transformed by resurrection. We are also, as a church, in the midst of a series in which we are doing one single worship service and Bible study on every single book of the Bible. And today is a consequential day. Today, we begin with the books of the prophets. The prophets, or as they are known in Hebrew, the Nevi'im, are the single largest section of books in the Old Testament. And we begin today with prophet Isaiah. Now, we hear the word prophet a lot in our culture, and I don't think that there's probably any figure more associated with prophecy than Nostradamus. And Nostradamus, of course, is that 16th century middle European figure who famously wrote strange and complex and opaque texts full of metaphors that predicted the future. And like so many others before him, most of Nostradamus's predictions did not come true. He has a 0-0 batting average, as we say in American baseball. Unlike Nostradamus, the biblical prophets do not prophesy specifically about future events like Nostradamus does. What they do is they are people at various levels of ancient Israelite society who receive somehow, that we just can't explain, a word from God that they must deliver to their people in earnest. And more often than not, that word is a word of rebuke. The people have violated the covenant that they've made with God and the covenant that they've made with each other. They've taken on practices that involve sometimes violence, sometimes desecrating holy places, sometimes worshiping other gods, or sometimes abandoning the covenant altogether. And the prophet comes to refocus the people on their fundamental commitment and on their relationship with God. The words of the prophets sound harsh to our ears. But when we take a moment to consider all of the lives that have been lost, all of the lands of former peoples that have been confiscated, and all of the power pressed down on those who are not as powerful, all this that has been necessary for the building up of modern American society, whatever the countervailing goods might be, when we consider the thing whole cloth, we realize that none of us escapes implication in some of these wider actions of our state and in our history. In the words of the greatest prophet of our modern era, Martin Luther King Jr., not all are guilty, but all are responsible. Not all are guilty, but all are responsible. There is no single sentence spoken by a modern public figure that so perfectly encapsulates the message of the prophets. The prophets are not here to get people feeling depressed or ashamed of themselves. They're not here to give people hang-ups and emotionally unhealthy spirituality. Instead, they arrive in order to rebuke a people who are doing wrong. And by rebuking them, by naming their sin, giving them the opportunity to repent of their sin and to be healed. And so as we break into the word of the prophets this morning, as we come before God and face rebuke, we can remember that God does not rebuke us simply to put us down. That when God gets involved and names our sin, it is because God desires to restore us to a deeper and richer relationship than we are currently in. And when God rebukes us as a people, as a church, it is because there is a church that we could be if only we set aside the things that are distracting us. So friends, as we gather this morning to listen to the word of the Lord, I would ask that you have your heart and your mind open. Perhaps God has a word to speak to you today. Will you join your hearts and your minds for worship? Our call to worship this morning comes from the book of Isaiah in the first chapter. Höret des Herrn Wort, ihr Fürsten von Sodom. Nimm zu Ohren unseres Gottes Gesetz, du Volk von Gomorra. Was soll mir die Menge eurer Opfer, spricht der Herr. Ich bin satt der Bandopfer von Widdern und des Fetten von den Gemästeten. Und habe keine Lust zum Blut der Fahren, der Lähmer und Böcke. Wenn ihr hier einkommt, er zu erscheinen von mir, wer fordert solches von Herrn Händen, dass ihr auf meinen Vorhof tretet? Bringt nicht mehr Speisopfer so vergeblich. Das Rauchwerk ist mir ein Gräuel. Nemonde und Sabbate, da ihr zusammenkommt. Frevel und Feistfeier mag ich nicht. Meine Seele ist Feind eurer Neumunden und Jahrfesten. Ich bin ihrer überdrüstig, ich bin's müde zu leiden. Und wenn ihr schon eure Hände ausbreitet, verberge ich doch meine Augen vor euch. Und ob ihr schon viel betet, höre ich euch doch nicht, denn eure Hände sind voll Blut. Waschet, reinigt euch, tut ihr böses Wesen von meinen Augen. Lass ab vom Bösen, lernet Gutes tun, trachtet nach Recht. Helfet dem Unterdrückten, schaffet dem Weisen Recht, führe der Witte Sache. So kommt denn und lasst uns miteinander rechten, spricht der Herr. Wenn er Sünde gleich blutrot ist, soll sie doch schneeweiß werden. Und wenn sie gleich ist wie Scharlach, soll sie doch wie Wolle werden. Wollt ihr mit Gehöchten
so sollt ihr des Landes gut genießen.
Come now, let us settle the matter, says the Lord.
Weiget ihr euch aber und seid ungehorsam, so sollt ihr von Schwert gefressen werden, denn der Mund des Herrn sagt es.
Friends, will you join me as we sing our first hymn this morning? Friends, let us enter into a time of prayer. How can we be in prayer with each other? What are you praying for? What's on your heart this morning?
You can pray for your mom and the pain she's in.
So Katie has asked that we be in prayer for my mom, who is experiencing a tremendous amount of back pain in the wake of a recovery from surgery. So if you would keep Martha Poland in your prayers. And also, while I'm at it, if you would keep my sister-in-law's father, Eric Larson, in your prayers. He is preparing to die of ALS. And so I thank you all for the support there. Martha Poland and Eric Larson. Are there others?
Pastor Kurt?
Yes, Sophia.
Could you also pray for safety for my mom? She's coming back home tomorrow, as far as I know, from Mexico. She's flying back.
We will absolutely pray that Elvia has a safe trip. Thank you, Sophia. Are there
Kurt? Kurt?
Yes, Walter. Yes,
it's
Walter.
Not the most, yeah, can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
Yeah, it's not the most orthodox prayer, but I mean, I'm guilty of this myself, but, you know, on social media, it's terrible. I some friends of mine are just, they vilified me because of my views on immigration and a few other matters, and I just feel like I don't like this mood of a lot of the country right now. You know what I mean? I don't want to go into all the details, but like people just attacking me for my views, and I try not to attack back. But you know, still I shouldn't even engage in this stuff. But you know, pray for a better mood. You know what I mean?
Yes.
You've done that before, but
yeah. You know, Walter, I'm going to preach this sermon on social media, I think sometime in the future. I am increasingly convinced that, I hear that prayer and I really validate that. And if I could say just a single word of it at this time, it would be that I think that social media brings out the worst in us, because it allows us to talk without any kind of expectation that we'll be physically and bodily present to each other. And I think that there's something that happens when we are fully present to each other in person. I think that we see each other as fellow human beings made in the image of God in a way that when we're acting as our avatars on social media, we don't have that extra element of accountability. So I just want to encourage you, Walter, and I'd say don't lose spirit. Thank you for your prayer this morning.
Okay. Yeah, because that's the field I'm involved in, you know, that's how I survive.
I understand. And we appreciate you doing that work.
Okay. Thanks, Kirk.
Are there others? Yes. Roger.
They call that cancel culture, don't they? What we're talking about with Walter there.
I think what they call it is sin.
People have the opportunity to say whatever they want online with no repercussions.
Yeah.
We spoke last week about the people at the cookie company that their daughter's has cancer. I talked to him during the week when he was open briefly, and his daughter is 15 years old, has cancer, kind of cancer. And he was saying that they took her to Children's Hospital, and he was shocked by a whole hospital full of children with cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And it was on my heart to think about them again. And you know, there's so many people that we could be praying for the trials that they're all suffering.
Amen. Would you remind me of her name, Walter? Roger. What was her name?
Danielle.
Thank you. We will keep Danielle and all children who are battling cancer right now in our prayers. Thank you, Roger. Are there others? Yes, Petra.
Yes, good morning, Pastor Kurt. Good morning, everybody. I just would like to give thanks today, because today is the birthday of my godchild, Alexander. Mm-hmm. He lives in Germany, and he's 24 today, and he just passed his master. And he is a healthy, very intelligent young man, and I'm very, very happy to have him in my life. And I just want to give thanks for having Alex as a godchild.
Hallelujah. We will give thanks for Alex and for his birthday today. Amen. Thank you, Petra. Are there others?
Okay. Well, I want to pray for reopening up. There are many churches reopened now. We have to ignore the whatever we hear on the radio, all the news and all this media. And we should remember that we live in a democratic country, and that we know about separation of church and state. I almost feel like we are in Daniel's side. You know, Nebuchadnezzar was prohibited to pray to our Almighty God. And so I think we should insist on and try to renew our faith through this time. That is what we are called for. Yeah.
Amen, Irini. so a prayer of safety as we move into the process of reopening churches, and a call on the church that if we want to reopen, it will take a commitment of time and effort and volunteers. And so we're going to have a conversation today about whether our church wants to reopen or not. And so if you want to be a part of that conversation, Irini, I would invite you.
There are many churches that already reopened. I have friends of mine that come from their churches, and Catholic churches open all the time. They never close, really. And
Irini, save this and bring it up at the end of the worship service when we have our meeting.
Okay, we'll talk about
And we'll see if our church wants to put forth the volunteer effort to reopen. That would be great if we want to do that. But I understand if people have reticence. So we're going to talk about it.
Pray about it. There will be possibility. Yeah.
Amen. Are there others?
The prayer.
Are there others? All right, friends, would you pray with me? Oh, let's see. Oh, congratulations, Petra. Yeah, I saw that in the chat. All right, will you pray with me, everyone? Lord, as we gather in this Lenten time, and as we begin our journey into the books of the prophets, we are reminded that when we come to church, all of us has but one question on our hearts. Is it true? Is it true that you called a people out where there was no people? Is it true that you have spoken to us? Is it true that you have given your word to prophets in the past that they might speak your truth even if the people did not want to hear it? Is it true that your son Jesus Christ walked in our midst, was human as we are human, died as we die, and was raised as we will be raised? Is it true? There are so many things in this world, Lord, that witness against what we hope would be true. And there are experiences that seem to contradict our faith that you are present with us. And so we ask, Lord, that on this morning, by the power of your Holy Spirit, in spite of all our human frailties and failings, that you would speak your word, because you alone have the words of eternal life. Your word alone endures forever. Lord, we pray for my mom, and we pray for Eric. And we ask for healing and peace. And we ask for the presence of your Spirit in their lives. And we pray for Elvia as she prepares to return home, that you keep her safe and return her home safe and sound. Lord, we pray that this technology that has opened up a new echelon of communication in our society, we pray for wisdom, and we pray for a moral compass as we digest these strange and powerful new tools. And we ask, Lord, that you would give us the wisdom and the insight and the humility not to mistake our social media avatars for ourselves, not to mistake Twitter likes for the support of real people, and not to mistake, my dog is digging on the couch, not to mistake lives on social media for lives embodied in our neighborhoods. Lord, we pray for Danielle, and we ask for healing for her and for all the children, Lord, who are battling cancer at an age way too young. We pray for their families and the hours of sleep lost and the fear and the frustration and the sadness. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for Alexander. And we give you thanks that he has such a wonderful godmother in Petra. We give you he graduated successfully with his master's degree. And we pray for a life of abundance and blessedness and the highest joy in human life, which comes from sharing our gifts with a community and being poured into by that community in turn. And finally, Lord, as we move into the stages of pooling our resources and committing our time to opening the doors of your church in the midst of a pandemic, we pray that you guide us, that you give us prudence and forbearance, grounded in a faith in you. Keep us open to receiving your word. Let us not be so overly confident in ourselves that we become deaf to your rebuke, because we are reminded, Lord, that the wisest among us are those who remain capable of being taught, and the most faithful among us are those who remain capable of being rebuked. Lord, all of these things we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who spoke his word of truth to us when he taught us how to pray, saying, Vater unser im Himmel, geheiligt werde dein Name, dein Reich komme, dein Wille geschehe, wie im Himmel, so auf Erden. Unser tägliches Brot gib uns heute und vergib uns unsere Schuld, wie auch wir vergeben unsere Schuldigen. Und führe uns nicht in Versuchung, sondern erlöse uns von dem Bösen. Denn dein ist das Reich und die Kraft und die Herrlichkeit in Ewigkeit. Amen. As always, I want to thank Mike for running the IT in the background and bringing us here to a time announcement. So just a few announcements. We're going to have a 30-minute church reopening team meeting today at 12:15. So we'll have some time for fellowship after the service, and then we'll have just a 30-minute conversation. We'll talk about the preliminary steps that we're going to be involved in reopening the church and the nature of volunteer commitment that we will require. And so we're aiming to be able to have our first in-person worship service on Easter Sunday morning, if we can. And so we're going to talk about the logistics of that. We will have to remain at 25% capacity if we do it inside. If we do it outside, we'll be able to get a little bit more, but there will be more information about that at the end of the service. If you would like to be a part of the team, to commit to being at the church a few Sundays out of the month, or if we decide to open just every few Sundays to be present when we do that, please stick around and be a part of that team meeting. I will say that the stipulation, the cost of entry into this group, is a volunteer commitment. Suggestions with volunteered bodies. Otherwise, it just gets too difficult to accommodate everyone. So if you'd like to volunteer, please stick around and be part of this conversation, and we will move forward together. We are also trying to make a high-quality online worship experience a mainstay of what our church offers. Now, we know deep in our souls that online worship doesn't actually replace the experience of in-person worship, but it can be a wonderful way of staying in touch and tethered to in-person worship on Sundays that we can't make it, or in times in our lives where there's a lot going on, especially when we have kids. And so if you would like to help us do this, if you would like to help us offer a robust online offering, we are trying to raise $10,000 in order to buy the equipment that we need, cameras, the hardware involved in switching between Zoom and live stream, computers and microphones. So we've raised $900 so far. Thank you all for your generosity. Please consider, if you are writing a check to us, putting tech in the memo line, or if you are giving online, you can make a little notation about giving to this technical fund. Thank you so much for your support. We are going to be picking up again in this series on one book of the Bible at a time in the into the prophetic tradition. And we are going to be listening to the word of the next greatest of all the prophets, the prophet Jeremiah, the prophet who famously said, "Why would you choose me? I am but a boy." The prophet who the of the great prophets, the one who wanted to refuse the call of God the most. And we are going to watch as Jeremiah is required in his time to stand up and preach a word the people did not want to hear, even in the face of other prophets telling the people what they did want to hear. And we will be discerning what it means to listen to the word of God, even when the word of God is the word that we don't want right now. So I hope that you'll join us, because it's going to be an exciting study as we continue. 6:30 p.m. on Wednesday on this same Zoom call. And so more podcasting to come. I have an interview with my father-in-law about Africans and Africa in the Bible that will go live this week, long overdue. He was a missionary in the Ivory Coast for 30 years, was formally knighted by the Ivorian government. So I can in truth say that my father-in-law is an African knight. And we will be talking about the enormous influence that Africans in Africa have had on the shaping of scripture. For those of you who are fans of European contributions to Christianity, unfortunately, this is an area where the Europeans have done almost nothing. Africans and Africa vastly outweigh European figures in influencing the composition of the scriptures and what comes from that. It was only later, as Christianity moved up into Europe, that Europeans began to have their say. So I hope that you'll listen to that podcast. I think it will give us some fertile soil for discussing what it means to read the Bible as a decolonized holy text. Finally, if you would like to continue to support the church, we are grateful to you. This is going to be necessary for the church going forward. And so I really appreciate those of you who are planting seeds for the future and committing your resources to making this worship service possible. If you would like to be a part of the future of the church in this way and see to it that German language ministry stays a part of what we offer here and stays a mainstay here in Los Angeles, then consider please giving online or by mail or even by text, following the instructions here on the screen or also on our website. Are there any other announcements for the good of the church this morning? All right, seeing none, let us continue in worship. A big thank you to Se Juan for her beautiful playing and to Alicia Emerson for her beautiful singing. Friends, our final reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. The prophet has arisen, has been called by God and charged with a word to deliver to the people. This is the people of Judah in exile in the city of Babylon. Here in the torpor and the uncertainty and the dissolution that comes when we lose hope of ever returning. But all of a sudden, over the course of weeks, a new emperor in the land, King Cyrus, the king of Persia, conquered the city of Babylon, the Babylonian Empire, and issued a new decree. All those peoples who had been taken away from their land and exiled into Babylon are now free to return and rebuild their cities and rebuild the worship at their temple. Now the question is not, will we ever return? The question has now become, in what manner will we return? It is to this new situation, to a community of Judahites, newly awakened to the possibility of returning across the wilderness to their homeland in Jerusalem, newly awakened to the possibility of restoring this holy nation that God called them to. It is to this situation that the prophet is called to speak. So hear now the word of Isaiah. Comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. Speak compassionately to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her compulsory service has ended, that her penalty has been paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice is crying out, clear the Lord's way in the desert, make a level highway in the wilderness for our God. Every valley will be raised up, and every mountain and hill will be flattened. Uneven ground will become level, and rough terrain, a valley plain. The Lord's glory will appear, and all humanity will see it together. The Lord's mouth has commanded it. A voice was saying, call out. And another said, what should I call out? All flesh is grass. All its loyalty is like the flowers of the field. The grass dries up and the flower withers when the Lord's breath blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass dries up, the flower withers. But the word of God will exist forever. Go up on a high mountain, messenger of Zion. Raise your voice and shout, messenger of Jerusalem. Raise it, don't be afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. Here is the Lord God, coming with strength, with a triumphant arm, bringing his reward with him and his payment before him. Like a shepherd, God will tend the flock. He will gather lambs in his arms and lift them into his lap. He will gently guide the nursing ewes. So ends the reading this morning. Will you pray with me? Lord, what should we cry out? All flesh is grass. The grass withers. The flower fades. And your word endures forever. Lord, we ask that in this moment, as mortal human words seek to speak your word of truth, that all that is mortal, that it might wither away, but that your word might endure.
We ask, Lord, that you speak to your church, that by the power of your word, you call your people to life once again, and that you set us a course across the wilderness, that we might return and be your holy people in your holy church. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen. What shall we cry? The voice asks. We're not told who asks this question. We're not told whose voice it is. It is one voice among several that we hear in this passage. The first voice that we hear is the voice of Isaiah. But his is a voice that is deigning to speak for God, because God has commanded him to do so. And in this moment, in this circumstance, in which a prophet rises up to speak the word of the Lord because the Lord has given him the word to do so, we have, in concentrated form, the essence of the faith of both Judaism and Christianity. Fundamental to our faith is a foundational trust that God has indeed spoken to us about himself, about his purposes for creating the world and humanity, and about who he would have us be in this time. There is, in the life of faith, a place for silence. There is, along the spiritual way, a place for meditation. But in the fullness of our experience, as people of the book, of people who, like Jesus, live by every word that comes from the mouth of God, there is a definitive moment in which God speaks, in which the word of the Lord is revealed, and in which the fundamental question of faith becomes no longer do we believe in God, but whether or not we will obey the word that has been spoken. In his immortal book on the prophets, the great Jewish theologian Abraham Joshua Heschel writes, "There are times when God speaks without equivocation, and the question of faith stops being a matter of belief and becomes a matter of obedience." We don't like the language of obedience as modern people. When we hear about the importance of obedience in the life of faith, maybe those in our community who lived under the East German communist regime will remember how conformist and how imposed state media was, and how obedience to law was made oppressive and compulsory. Others of us who may have had experiences in our lives of churches that were fundamentalist and reactionary in their orientation will hear the language of obedience as sequestering human desire to understand, as tamping down human imagination, and as driving to frustration human questions. I understand these experiences. And one of the great things that the modern world has added to the life of faith
is a space for us to be individual people, a space for us to wrestle and discern for ourselves what our faith actually looks like and what it might mean for us, whole cloth, to follow the word that God gives. In other words, what modernity, what our contemporary age of government by the people, for the people, of self-expression and identity, what our age asks is that we not simply take on the faith of a previous generation, but rather that we bring ourselves to the table and see what it means to make the faith of the Bible our own faith. And yet, there is a temptation that our modern sensibilities sometimes bring to the fore. There's a temptation to stop making our spiritual lives about faithfulness to God and to start making our spiritual lives something of our own. And if there is any truth about Christian spirituality, it is this: your spiritual life is not about you. Christ's spiritual life was not about him. In his ministry, he constantly turned people back to the God he called Father, or stirred to life their own experience of the presence of the Spirit. If we, as people of faith, think that church is a matter of building up an institution where we prefer to be, where our predilections are baptized, where our particular desires and wants are tailored and accommodated. In other words, if we make church a place that serves our taste, we make church a place where the word of God is tamped down, and we threaten to become people who stop being able to hear the word of God altogether. Imagine the experience for a moment of the people of Judah in Babylon. They had spent so much time in exile that they'd adjusted the rhythms of their lives to make do. They'd spent so much time under the power of a government and a people who did not know or care to know the God that they were serving and the laws that they were keeping, that they began to wonder in the depths of their spirits if they would ever return or if they would face an inevitable dissolution of their identity, individually and as a people. And then all of a sudden, a way where there was no way before is opened up to them. All of a sudden, they find themselves no longer people in exile, but simply people living, expats living in a foreign place. All of a sudden, the way back to Jerusalem is opened up to them. But a people who's lived in exile for so long grows accustomed to the rhythms of exile, grows accustomed to the narrative of exile, grows accustomed to being a people in exile. And so when Isaiah receives the word of God to speak to the people of Judah and to summon them to cross the wilderness one more time and to return home to the holy city, he is speaking as much to people who have their lifelong desired to return as he is to people who have grown comfortable living in exile. The first word that he speaks is not a word of rebuke. The first word that God gives him to speak is comfort. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak compassionately to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her compulsory service has ended and that her penalty is paid. Friends, we, like these Judahites in Babylon, have now grown accustomed to the rhythms of exile. It's almost a year since we closed the doors of the church and all locked down in quarantine. And though this has been difficult, I can speak truthfully for myself when I say there's much about the introvert inside of me that is like to being locked down. We've learned a lot as a society about how to work from home. And at least if we don't have kids, the experience of being at home in many ways has not been all that bad. But now that vaccines are going into arms of our fellow citizens and maybe even arms to people on this call this morning, the way is beginning to open up for us to return. And the question before us now is the question that was before these Judahites. It's not a question of whether they will return, but a question rather of the manner in which they will return, and more specifically about who they will be as a people when they return. The prospect of getting all of our ducks in a row, the prospect of getting a policy in volunteers there and present on Sunday morning in order to reopen the church is a daunting prospect. It's going to require organization and delegation. It's going to require commitment and intention. And there will inevitably be some risk involved, a risk that must be assessed and an occasion that must be risen to. It's enough to remind us of how much we don't know, to remind us of how many uncertain factors there are, to remind us that we human beings are mortal and prone to make errors. A voice cries out, "What shall I cry? All flesh is grass. The grass withers and the flower fades." And the grass does wither. The flower does fade. We are mortal. We are human. We are imperfect, and our perspective is limited. There are going to be factors when we try to reopen the church that we do not control. There will be people who come who do not want to wear masks. There will be people who come who do not want to social distance. There will be people who come who want to be able to sing hymns in the sanctuary. And we are going to have to operate as a different kind of church when we return, if we are going to be able to stay returned. And we are going to be able to let these types of people down easy. There will be situations that we encounter that we don't entirely know how to meet. But it is to this anxiety about our own mortality, our own limits, that Isaiah, speaking for God, speaks a word of comfort. All flesh is grass. The grass withers and the flower fades. But the word of God endures forever. Friends, if we want to return, simply make the church a nice club where like-minded people or people of a similar culture simply come together to have lunch on a Sunday morning, it won't work. The only way that we can actually return as a church is if the word of God is our chief priority. And that is because, friends, the only thing that builds up the church is the word of God and the presence of God. If we try to build the church on any other foundation, the humanity, the mortality, and the frailty of that foundation will quickly evince itself. If a church is not founded on this strange and powerful memory, if the church is not built on a foundation of fundamental confidence and faith that God is still speaking God's eternal word to the world, and that the church is a place where people gather specifically to listen for, discern, and respond to this word. If the word of God is not what the church gathers around, then friends, the church has no reason to exist. What acts of justice we can do will be done at a greater scale and with greater resources by other nonprofit organizations around us. What cultural celebrations we can do will be done with much more vividness and depth of cultural understanding by the cultural organizations that surround us in our city. It's about a club where we simply get together to gossip and eat. There are living rooms and restaurants all around the city that will be more accommodating to that kind of activity. But if we aim to do justice, if we aim to let our culture grow out of our fundamental commitment to the word of God, and if our way of being together is a way that is opened out to God's transformation, that by our fellowship, we might build each other up more and more into the image of Christ, more and more into a people authored by the word of God. If this is our purpose, then friends, I invite you with your mortality, your frailty, your small human position in the world, I invite you to join with me nevertheless as we seek to discern what it will mean for us to cross the wilderness and to return home. God will make a way. Even in spite of our failings, God will make a way. Because the word of God endures. And it will rise up and raise up churches that pay attention to it, even if our church does not pay attention to it. And we will see, friends, that if we do make the word of God our chief priority, the resources to continue in ministry, the volunteers that we need to rebuild our church, and the community relationships that we need to make a difference in the city, all of these will be raised up and made plain to us. The places of uncertainty will be discerned. The high mountains that we fear to climb will be laid low. The valleys that we fear we might be drawn down into will be raised up. The rough places will be made plain, says the word of God. God makes a way for those who would obey him. So confer with your spirit. Ask yourself why you come to church. And if there has ever been an enduring, immortal word, an eternal word that God has spoken to you through the folly of my trying to speak to you every single Sunday morning, then bear witness to it. Stand up on a high mountain, you messenger of Zion. Raise your voice and shout. Don't be afraid. Say to us, here is your God. Because it is time, friends, for our church to begin to share testimony. It's time for our church to begin to share what God has been doing. It's time for our church to risk committing ourselves to God's word in our midst. The founder of the Methodist movement, John Wesley, famously said that a church cannot survive with a single preacher. Not only does the church need more than one ordained preacher, but the church needs lay preachers, people who are not ordained, people who are simply there in earnest and honestly to rise up from time to time and to share what God has been doing in their lives and how they are understanding God's word to them and to the church in this time. To be a person of faith, friends, is to take a risk. It's to step up on a high mountain from time to time and to claim what you believe God is saying to you and to the church. That can be embarrassing for us moderns. We moderns like to hedge our bets. We moderns like to reserve judgment. we see it as a worldly virtue to try to take in every possible perspective before we commit to anything. But the truth is, friends, that the time for action is now. The truth is, friends, that what God has given you is sufficient. Now it's time for you to give what God has given to you to the church. I want to invite you to find out together as a community what it will mean for us to return. I want to invite you to share your heart, to share the truth that God has revealed to you, because we cannot be the church of Jesus Christ unless all of the members are living and active. And then I want to encourage you, if you feel like you don't understand enough of the Bible, if you feel like you don't understand enough of what the church is for and what separates the church from other organizations in our society, if you feel like you're just not that good of a Christian, I want to encourage you. The main time to be a person of faith is today. In a certain way, it doesn't matter what you've done in the past. And it doesn't even matter what you're planning to do in the future. Jesus prays to God and says, "Give us this day our daily bread." Friends, what would it mean for you to be the person God is calling you to be today? What would it mean for you to read God's word of comfort? And then, like Isaiah, to dare to stand up and share that word with the people. There's never any certainty in the life of faith. There's no getting a PhD in being a Christian. What we are called to is not to always be right. We're not called to be superhuman. We are called to be honest, to bear witness to our experience, both of God's presence and of God's absence. The church is a place for this kind of witness. If we decide that we are going to risk putting our trust in a God who speaks rather than in a God who remains silent and ultimate far away, we will begin, I think, to understand what it means to take on as our own the faith stored up for us in the scriptures, and what it will mean for us to call ourselves disciples of the Lord Jesus. If we endeavor with our whole selves, with both our strengths and our weaknesses, to follow God in faith and to share the word of God as it is revealed to us, then like a shepherd, God will tend the flocks. He will gather his lambs in his arms and lift them onto his lap, and he will gently guide us weak, delicate, failing, and frail nursing ewes. The good news is that God is calling you, your whole mortal person, because it is with real human beings, weaknesses and strengths, that God builds the church. Friends, there is a voice crying out, "In the wilderness, make a highway that we might return." I want to invite you to run, you to run,
Sorry about that. Kurt should be back in just a moment. All right, so Katie just said Kurt's computer lost internet as well, so.
Hi, everybody. I'm back on Katie's computer. Case in point, frailty, right? Perfection doesn't make the church. So I want to invite you, in spite of our penchant to fail, our frailty, and everything else, to take a risk in faith and to be a part of our team that's going to reopen the church. I understand if you have hesitancy about being there in person, and that's okay. I want you to tell your truth about that. But it is time for our church not to simply share our ideas with the pastor, but to start organizing to share ideas with each other, because it will be as a church, as a people, that we return. We can, if we choose to, bicker and argue and disagree. And that will mean that in the eventual time when we are returned, we will return as a cohort of bickering opponents. Or we can choose to see ourselves in a different light. We can recognize that none of us has the final answer, that all of us is seeking the word of God, and that we together can make this journey, even if we disagree, because we are a pilgrim people with a common destination. Friends, I want to invite you to be pilgrims this morning. I want to invite you to travel with me across this wilderness time as we discern and as we try to see the best in our fellow pilgrims. If we do this, if we walk humbly in this way, God will be with us. God will restore us. God will shepherd our flock. It is, at the end of the day, as simple as that. Are we going to obey the word that God has given us? And are we going to share it with others? Because if we do, we will find abundance on the other side of wilderness that we were not expecting. So I invite you to discern together as we begin to make this journey.
At the very beginning of this service for our Eingangswort, we heard a word from Isaiah 1 about how God despises our festivals, despises the new moon celebrations and the offerings that we're bringing, because we have abandoned the plight of the widow and the orphan. God promises in those early words in the book of Isaiah that if we get our priorities straight, God will be with us. But that if we don't have our priorities straight, there is no way we are going to make it. Then in chapter 40 that we just heard, God promises a word of comfort and that God will make a way. So friends, let's have a conversation at the end of our fellowship time about what our priorities are going to be and then how we would like to be a part ourselves of this reopening process. Go in peace this week to love and serve the Lord, who will bring you out of exile and across the wilderness.
Thank you, everyone, for being here today, and we will stay. Oh, dear. We're going to get some feedback here. We're going to stay and have some fellowship, and then at 12:15, we will have our 30-minute meeting to get some of the preliminaries discussed for reopening. So thank you for being here. Let's be in fellowship.
Yeah. And